بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، حمدا يوافي نعمه يكافي ومزيده. يا ربنا لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك ولعظيم سلطانك. سبحانك لا نحصي ثناء عليك، انت كما اثنيت على نفسك. فلك الحمد حتى ترضى، ولك الحمد اذا رضيت، ولك الحمد بعد الرضا. اللهم صل وسلم على سيدنا محمد في الاولين، وصل وسلم على سيدنا محمد في الاخرين، وصلي وسلم على سيدنا محمد في كل وقت وحين، وصلي وسلم على سيدنا محمد في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين، وصلي وسلم على سيدنا محمد حتى تلك الأرض ومن عليها، أنت خير الوارثين. نويت تعلم وتعليم وتذكر التذكير، نفع انتفاع والإفادة والاستفادة، والحث على التمسك بكتاب الله وبسنة رسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، ودعاء إلى الهدى ودلالة على الخير، ابتغاء وجه الله ومرضاته وقربه وثوابه سبحانه وتعالى. We're on chapter 26 of the work of Imam al-Tirmidhi رحمه الله تعالى, in the Shama'il of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, entitled باب ما جاء في صفة إدام رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. What has been narrated concerning the description of the condiment of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, an idam, condiment, as translated, anything that is eaten alongside bread, that which you eat alongside bread is known as a condiment. وبي إليه قال حدثنا محمد بن سهل بن عسكر وعبد الله بن عبد الرحمن قال حدثنا يحيى بن حسان حدثنا سليمان بن بلال عن هشام بن عروة عن أبيه عن عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم قال نعم الإدام الخل. قال عبد الله في حديثه نعم الأدم أو الإدام الخل. The first tradition of the Messenger of Allah on authority of Sayyidina Aisha رضي الله تعالى عنها وارضاها, the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said what an excellent condiment إدام vinegar is. Abdullah ibn Abdul Rahman stated in his narration, he said, what excellent condiments, or what an excellent condiment vinegar is. And the hadith here, the hadith mutawatira, it's one of those few traditions that reach the highest level of certainty in terms of their transmission. And there are different asbab al-wurud, and the different reasons why this actual hadith was articulated by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by different circumstances. And what is well known is the circumstance in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as oft mentioned throughout the book, has now liberated Mecca sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and is in the house of Umm Hani, the elder sister of Sayyidina Ali karamallaha wajhuhu. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam is now brought bread sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, just bread for him to consume sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Alaysa laki idam, don't you have an idam, anything to eat with bread? And so she brings the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam some vinegar, to which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam remarks, نعم الإدام خل, and what an excellent condiment and vinegar is. And the Imams are in a similar situation occurs in the house of Salama, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, virtually verbatim, virtually similar. And so the Imams rahimahullah ta'ala have different understandings as to why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said what he said. Some of them say that it's bayan al-waqi'ah, that the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is just clarifying the reality of vinegar, that there's nothing that is greater for a person to consume alongside bread than vinegar. And in the diet of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu wardahu, Sayyidina Umar places that as one of the meals of the 7 days. And it is bread with vinegar, and it is the supreme condiment. Others, they say it's what's called Jabr al-Khawatir. The Jabr al-Khawatir is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam now is what is taken into consideration, the feelings, quote unquote, of those who bring in the Prophet some vinegar. Yani for example, Hani, then the Hani just brings the Prophet some bread without the vinegar, it shows you that she does not necessarily see vinegar as a condiment to have with bread. And again, excuse the phrase, due to poverty, that's all she has. And so the Prophet وسلم, in order to take her feelings into consideration, the Rasul وسلم, and what a blessed condiment vinegar is. وبي إليه قال حدثنا قتيبة حدثنا أبو الأحواس عن سماك بن حارب قال سمعت النعمان بن بشير يقول ألستم في طعام وشراب ما شئتم؟ لقد رأيت نبيكم صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم يجد من الدقل ما يملأ بطنه. حديث سماك بن حرب وزرهيد نعمان بن بشير رضي الله عنه وارضاه say, do you all not indulge in food and drink as much as you like? I saw your Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at times unable to find even the lowest quality of dates with which to fill his stomach sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Hakada, and as you said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, yani out of preference that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam chose not to indulge in the maladhat of the dunya sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. It's always important that we look at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to understand that he was given sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam khazain al-ard, the mafatih khazain al-ard, the keys to the storehouses of the earth sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And so when you see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he living in such a way sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ikhtiyaran la ittiraran, it's out of choice, not that he's forced due to circumstance sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but this is a lifestyle choice for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. The more we consume here, the more we lose there. And I gather the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is showing us, not for the Nabi. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are free, the dunya wal akhirah. Yeah, it's al-hurriya mutlaq for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, absolute freedom inside of the world. But the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, uswatul hasana. He's an example for his ummah. Yani now, shuf, Allah ta'ala for us, we've got to choose one of the darain. And the ones who choose this world lose the next. And the ones who forsake this world, they gain the next. Hakada, the bargain that we struck with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ubi ilayhi qala hadathana abda ibn abdillah al-khuza'i, hadathana mu'awiyah ibn hisham an sufyan an muhalib ibn dithar an jabir ibn abdillah radiallahu ta'ala anhuma qala rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam ni'mal idamu al-khalb. I got a tradition now in the Thaji Sayyidina Jabir radiallahu anhu wa ta'ala, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, what an excellent condiment vinegar is. وبي إليه قال حدثنا حماد حدثنا وكيع عن سفيان عن أيوب عن أبي قلابة عن زهدان الجرمي قال كنا عند أبي موسى الأشعري وأوتي بلحم دجاج تنحى رجل من القوم فقال ما لك؟ فقال إني رأيتها تأكل شيئا فحلفت أن لا آكلها. قال أذنوا فإني رأيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وصحبه وسلم يأكل لحم الدجاج. Tradition on the authority of Zahdam al-Jarmi, he said that once we were in the company of Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, the great companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in Ashab al-Safina, from the people of the ship, those migrants from the Yemen, from Banu al-Ash'ira, who migrated to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam via the Red Sea, thereby shipwrecked into Abyssinia, and thereby they meet up with Sayyidina Ja'far radiallahu anhu wa rah, and those second migrants to Abyssinia. And thereby when the Prophet summons them, Sayyidina Ja'far and those with him in Abyssinia, to now return or to come to Medina, to Munawwara, to migrate to Medina. When they arrived, Sayyidina Abu Musa alongside Sayyidina Ja'far, and they were informed the Rasul وسلم, of the journey that they took, the Prophet وسلم, considered them dhu hijrataini. He said, your people have made two migrations. Although their intent was only one migration from Yemen all the way to Medina to Munawwara, but in that they were shipwrecked to Abyssinia and thereby remained in Abyssinia, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam considered them to be people of two migrations, i.e. moving from Zabid, Banu al-Ash'ira, toward Akzum in Abyssinia, the first migration for them. And then the second migration from Abyssinia, Akzum, all the way to Medina al-Munawwara with Sayyidina Ja'far. So this is one of the great imams of the religion, Sayyidina Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, from the fuqaha, the sahaba, those who reached the highest degree of learning among the Sahaba radiallahu anhu wa rah, and the greatest qurra of the Quran, the greatest reciters of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ka'annahu utiya mazamir, and mizmar bin mazamir Dawood. It's as if he's been given one of the vocal cords of the vocal cords of Sayyidina Dawood. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in his regard, in Abdullah ibn Qais, rahimahullah ta'ala. And so we were once in a company of Abu Musa al-Ash'ari when some chicken was brought. A man distanced himself from the group, upon which he said, what is the matter with you? It's Abu Musa addressing him. Because he sort of, instead of coming close in order to partake in the food, this man begins to distance himself from what the food in and of itself. The man replied, I saw the chicken eating something. Okay? What do you mean eating something? Something foul.
Because, you know, chickens are like scavengers. They're not going to differentiate between what they eat. And so this man has just thrown that chicken, the chicken that has just been slaughtered and now being cooked and saved, he saw that chicken eating something foul. But the reality, what they found inside the Medina cave, is from the soil that the Prophet ﷺ tried upon. And so said Abu Musa, rahimahullah, udnu, and come close. Eat, I come close and eat, partake. Why? For I saw the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam eat chicken meat. I mean, leave your intellect to yourself. Yeah, heck, just leave your intellect to yourself. In that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ate chicken, then you eat chicken, regardless. And chickens, well known, they're scavengers, yeah, they're scavengers. You don't differentiate in terms of the food that they eat. Although there are some of the fuqaha who say that a chicken, once a chicken, now it's been ready to be slaughtered, that a chicken must be what? Must be in quarantine for 3 days. That is a position amongst Ahlul Islam. The chickens must first be quarantined, and they must be fed, quote unquote, clean, quote unquote, food, and then thereby, after that 3 day quarantine, that the chicken is slaughtered. And that's a position amongst the fuqaha, but it doesn't dominate, quote unquote, okay? And so the point is here is that what? If the Rasul Sa'isim did it, we do it. We don't ask no questions. And wa bi ilayka al hadathan al fadl ibn Sahil al A'raj al Baghdadi. حدثنا إبراهيم بن عبد الرحمن بن مهدي عن إبراهيم بن عمر بن سفينة عن أبيه عن جده قال أكلت مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لحم حبارة يعني on the authority يعني of سفينة okay his grandfather إبراهيم بن عمر بن سفينة and the سفينة here who is the freed slave of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم سفينة the ship because his name it's a laqab for the ship, because he could carry great loads upon his back, that which nobody else could bear upon their back. We used to call him Safina, that great companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and with desired cry, when he saw the realization of death, death being separation, came unto him, radiallahu anhu, wa rahi, he cried. Why? Because he's with the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he cries that in death, shuf, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ya Rasulullah, Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ya Rasulullah, you were, yani. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, يعني the Prophet be in the maqam al asna in the highest station inside the Jannah Allah, the paradise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But من معه, who's with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And so Safina there, sure, he realizes inside of the next world, no matter where he's placed inside of Jannah, if he's not with the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then what, quote unquote, what is life thereafter, even in the hereafter? And so he cries, radiallahu anhu wa rahmah. That, no doubt, those instances immortalized by the great Imam, Imam al-Habashi, rahimahullah ta'ala, Ali bin Muhammad al-Habashi, when he says that paradise, yani has, I have no desire for paradise, save that my beloved is there. And my beloved, that the Prophet Sa'isim is there. Without having ma'ir of the Rasul Sa'isim in Jannah, then what then is Jannah? What then is Jannah? And haka the safina, and the Prophet Sa'isim informs him, anta ma'a man ahbabta, you're with the one whom you love, yani. A love is what gives you ma'iyah. And akada, when we study the science of shama'il, akada has to be objectives. Okay? And although na'an, Rabbi zidni ilma, we're increasing in knowledge. Ilm al-Nabi, knowledge of the Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Knowledge is a mere wasila, but there's a maqsood. There's an objective of this knowledge. And the objective of the knowledge, mahabba, love of the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in order to attain ma'iyah, in order to attain witness with the Nabi, sallallahu alayhi وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم هكذا سيدنا السفينة يعني مولى رسول الله يعني رسول رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم the messenger of God in the famous tradition when سيدنا السفينة رضي الله عنه وراه has been sent on a mission with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم by the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and when he's returning سيدنا السفينة gets lost from Arabia in the times of the Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم full of jungle track okay and so he gets lost inside of one of these jungle tracks Sayyidina Safina radiallahu anhu wardahu, and thereby he's confronted by a lion. He's confronted by a lion, Sayyidina Safina. And Sayyidina Safina, shuf, an authority from the Nabi, because he'd been sent by the Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he addresses the lion, that I'm Safina, the freed slave of the Messenger of God and the Messenger of the Messenger of God. He's been sent upon a message. And he's addressing the lion, I've been lost. So you, this is your land here, you've got to show me the way out of here. And so the lion, Safina says, the lion like lowers his head, and does this, yeah, does that, beckons with his head. And so the lion begins to move, and Safina now begins to follow the lion. Not like Safina, not the lion go that way, and Safina like, dash the other way now, get away with the lion. He's following the lion. Imagine the lion is leading Sayyidina Safina. Until the lion now leads Sayyidina Safina, radiallahu anhu, to a road, a well-known road, and the lion like with his head motions, now you move on that road, you're good now. And so Safina takes to the road. And so Safina says, when he leads to the road, the lion roars. Rah! And he said, my only understanding, what he was bidding me farewell, sadness that it was now departing from me. So a lion, quote unquote, now sad that it departs from Safina. Safina sad, just of the thought that he's departing from the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam with the phenomena, the inevitable phenomena that is known as death. Hakada, those, mashallah ta'ala, who are on a mission, and he bid Nabi. And so he's telling us, saying that Safina ate the meat of Hubara, yani, which is busted, and a beard, avian, yani, with the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. وبي إليه قال حدثنا علي بن حجر حدثنا إسماعيل بن إبراهيم عن أيوب عن القاسم التميمي عن زهدم الجرمي قال كنا عند أبي موسى الأشعري قال فقدم طعام وقدم في طعامه لحم الدجاج وفي القوم رجل من بني تيم لا أحمر كأنه مولى قال فلم يدنو فقال له أبو موسى أدنو إني رأيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أكل منه فقال إني رأيته يأكل شيئا فقذرته فحلفت أن لا أطعمه أبدا. Okay, and so here the same similar tradition but more expanded upon, يعني by Zahdam al-Jarmi, he once in the company of Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, his food was brought for him. Some chicken meat was included in it. There was an individual in the group, a man of reddish complexion from the tribe of Taymullah, who appeared to be a freed slave, who did not come near to partake of the meal. So Abu Musa, radiallahu anhu, said to him, come close, for I saw the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, eat it. The man said, I saw the chicken eating something, and I found it distasteful. So I swore that I would never eat of it again. And what Abu Musa al-Ash'ari is saying, break it, so break your oath. Yani. وبي إليه قال حدثنا محمود بن غيلان حدثنا أبو الأحمد الزبيري وأبو نعيم قال حدثنا سفيان عن عبد الله بن عيسى عن رجل من أهل الشام يقال له عطاء عن أبي أسيد قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كلوا زيت ودهنوا به إنه من شجرة مباركة. Hadith of Abu Asid who reports, radiallahu anhu, reports that the Messenger of Allah said, eat olive oil. And the kulu zayt, zayt here, although it's oil in general, but it means what? The zayt of zaytun. Zayt can be used as a general term for any oil, but it's more particular for zayt, zaytun, and the oil of the what? Of the olive, of the olive tree. Eat zaytun and apply its oil to you, okay? And it would dehinu bihi, and you oil yourselves in it. The Prophet is saying, why? Because it comes from a blessed tree. يعني من شجرة مباركة. رحمه الله تعالى والتين والزيتون وطور سينين وهذا البلد الأمين. Allah تعالى swears by the zaytun, by the olive tree, سبحانه وتعالى. And Allah سبحانه وتعالى لا يقسم إلا بالمعظم. Allah تعالى only swears by that which is great, سبحانه وتعالى. The olive tree is great, it's sacred, it's blessed from a blessed land. In another riwayah, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إنه من شجرة مباركة يعني في أرض مباركة. And the Luwai Prophet says it's from a sacred tree, a blessed tree, from a sacred or a blessed land. Subhanallah, the Asra bi Abdi Layla min al-Masjid al-Haram al-Masjid al-Aqsa alladhi barakna hawla. Allah Ta'ala says, the land that we blessed its surroundings, the great land of Jerusalem, Jar al-Salam, the neighborhood of peace, the neighborhood of the divine, Jalla Jalalu wa Ta'ala Abamatu. وبي إليه قال حدثنا يحيى بن موسى حدثنا عبد الرزاق عن بأنا معمر عن زيد بن أسلم عن أبيه عن عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله تعالى عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كل الزيت ودهنوا به فإنه من شجرة مباركة. A similar tradition, the authority of Sayyidina Umar and in the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, eat olive oil and apply its oil unto you, for it comes from a blessed tree, from a blessed tree. And that's the highest continuum of oil, yani. There's no oil that is higher than olive oil. I mean, it's the oil of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And then, mashallah ta'ala, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam uses it, he's gonna consume, yani, consumes it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's in the food of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. That when the Sahabiyat are going to quote on one to cook, yani, using oil, you can call it fry or what have you, that's going to be prepared oil in that regard. It can be taken hot, it can be taken cold. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is going to apply it to his blessed hair, to his blessed beard, to his blessed body. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the supreme oil. And it's not going to be said about any other oil that it has the rank of olive oil in and of itself. And again, modern studies have affirmed that in its regard. We did make mention of ban oil, yani moringa oil, which also has a place in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but not to the same degree as well as olive oil in that regard. Yani قال أبو عيسى وعبد الرزاق كان يضطرب في هذا الحديث فربما أسنده وربما أرسله. Okay. يعني عبد الرزاق يعني الله أعلم what the word shaky يعني in this hadith يعني it just means عبد الرزاق. And sometimes when عبد الرزاق يا صنعاني, the great Imam of صنعاء inside of the Yemen رضي الله عنه ورضاه, and the Sheikh of the Imam, Sheikh of الشافعي, the Sheikh of أحمد رضي الله عنه ورضاه. يعني so perhaps he related it directly to the narrator, or perhaps he related it only to the sub narrator. Okay, يعني what's meant here, يعني أسندا وأرسلا. أسندا, that is, there's a complete transmission, unbroken transmission to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam through Umar. That's أسند. Okay, that includes, for instance, in this example, includes Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab inside of the transmission. أرسلا, he will exclude Sayyidina Umar, so the hadith becomes مرسل. A hadith that is mursal is where the tabi'i connects directly to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam without the sahaba. هكذا لم يكن, that's not possible. A sahaba can't relate, a tabi'i can't relate from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because they never saw the Nabi. They're not in the presence of the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so thereby we know this suqut, there's a person missing inside of the chain of transmission there. Okay, and that type of hadith you call a mursal. Called a mursal hadith. Like it means in Arabic, arsalahu. He misses out the companion, the one who actually met the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, heard, took, saw that which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi was doing. Obviously, the hukum of a mursal hadith is da'if. Ordinarily, it's called it's a da'if tradition. Okay, da'if tradition. In that now, there's inqita' fi sanad, that the transmission is broken at some point. In this case, it's broken at the level of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu wa ra. Although many of the Imams rahimahullah ta'ala yastashhiduna bihi, they will use it as a proof. And here, the great Imams do that. Yeah. The likes of Sa'id ibn Musayyib, the likes of Sayyidina Hum, Hassan al-Basri, the great Imams, they will relate directly from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, although they never met him, yani, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, meaning that they're missing out the Sahaba. And one of the sirs there in spirituality is just qurb al-Nabi, just to be proximate to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yani, as if you took it from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, wa la mani'a. And also there's no quote-unquote prohibitive, not prohibitive in the regard that these imams are rijal, they're not just the imam of the wahid, but they're the imams of the bawatin, the spiritual yani. Who says they didn't take it from the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Who says? I mean, there's many imams in our tradition, is that either ashkala alayhim, if they ever became sort of confused as to whether the hadith was da'if or whether it was sahih, that they would then see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yaqadha. It was way after the fact of the Nabi. They would see the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a wake state, and then he would ask the question to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَصَحِيحٌ أَمْ لَا? Is this sahih أَمْ لَا? أَقُلْتَهُ أَمْ لَا? Did you say this tradition أَمْ لَا? Or not? And then the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam give them the appropriate answer. And it's always important to remember that, yani. In the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there are no people in any generation that are higher in spiritual rank than the imams of these transmissions. The imams of the transmissions of Bukhari, the transmissions of Muslim, or the transmission herein of a Tirmidhi, rahimahullah ta'ala, awliya. And these are awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But obviously, in terms of what the outer sciences, there has to be quote unquote rules, yani rules for how we adjudicate a tradition to be sahih, or a tradition to be hasan, or a tradition to be da'if. And in terms of both sahih as well as hasan, they can't be what? Inqita' fi sanad. There must be ittisal. The sanad, the transmission, must connect. Jeel and jeel, okay? Generation upon generation. هكذا تلمذي once, رحمه الله تعالى. وبي إليه قال حدثنا السنجي وهو أبو داود سليمان بن معبد المروزي السنجي حدثنا عبد الرزاق عن معمر عن زيد بن أسلم عن أبيه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم نحوه ولم يذكر فيه عن عمر. Okay, yani here the tradition on authority of Zayd ibn Aslam and the authority yani of his father, who reported the tradition from the Prophet with a meaning similar to the aforementioned, though he did not mention in it on the authority of Umar, meaning Umar ibn al-Khattab رضي الله تعالى عنه وأرضاه. وبه إليه قال حدثنا محمد بن بشار حدثنا محمد بن جعفر وعبد الرحمن بن مهدي قال حدثنا شعبة عن قتادة عن أنس بن مالك رضي الله تعالى عنه قال كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يعجبه الدباء فأوتي بطعام أو دعي له فجعلت أتبعه فأضعه بين يديه لما أعلم أنه يحبه. Saying Anas rahimahullah ta'ala, he said that the Prophet ﷺ liked gourd, dubba, I liked it. Okay, the term he actually used, he loved it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it's not that the Prophet ﷺ loves gourd, because again, a principle in food, and a principle in drink, and a principle in dunya ajma' for the Prophet ﷺ is that he has an indifference. He's indifferent to it, sallallahu alayhi wa. He has no love of something, he has no hatred of something, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he's indifferent. That's the highest maqam that a person can have. The lowest that somebody loves that which is from the dunya. Yani mid-rank, somebody hates the dunya. But as the great woman, Sayyidina Rabi'a radiallahu anha wardaha, when somebody said that I have rejected the world, she said if it wasn't in your heart, then you wouldn't reject it. The fact that it's inside of your heart, then you're rejecting something inside of your heart. I mean, there's a maqam higher than rejection of the dunya in and of itself. What is that? An indifference to it. And the Prophet ﷺ has an absolute indifference to dunya. And so of the main manifestation of the dunya, that is, for the human being, there is no dunya greater for the human being than food and drink. Food and drink. If you take that aspect of dunya away from man, everything else gets alasha. Nothing else has any meaning whatsoever. And money has no meaning whatsoever in the absence of food and drink. And what about shuyukh? There, yani, Abu Shuykh, the grandson of Habib Ibrahim bin Aqil, he once mentioned about the people from Hadramaut who went to make Hajj. Okay, and so from Hadramaut, he went to make Hajj, not through the ordinary quote unquote in borderline stops, but they'd gone through from Hadramaut. You can access in quote unquote Saudi Arabia for the Rub' al-Khali, the empty quarter, the greatest sort of uninhabited mass of land upon the earth. They say the Rub' al-Khali. And so the entrance with the Rub' al-Khali dangerous, yani, because it's just desolate, yani. You get lost there, it's over. And so now usually when on the Akkadic tradition had remote to go for the Rub' al-Khali, and so now when they arrive in Saudi Arabia, yani, without going through a border, yani, that well, then they usually phone their family upon the other side, we've arrived safely. And so this party of people never phoned, yani, they never phoned that they'd arrived safely. And so they're waiting, no phone call comes. So they send a search party into the Rub' al-Khali, into the empty quarter, to look for them. And they found them. Every one of them, mayyitun, every one of them had died. And what they noticed, because they got lost in the Rub' al-Khali, they couldn't survive. I know you take all your money for the Hajj, etc., etc., etc. What they noticed is that the money that they had, they'd ripped it to shreds. Because they reached a point where they realized, what's the use of money now? And mayyitun, yani. And we're dead. And money's not going to benefit in the midst of what the Rub' al-Khali showed you, shuf. Because many of us quote, well, you may see money as well as the ultimate manifestation of dunya, la, like it's food and drink. And that's why he, even in there's two things the human being needs. What is that? It's food, yani food and drink, and security. And that's why Allah Ta'ala, li ila fi Quraysh, ila fi tashita hi was safe. Fal ya'budu rabba hadha al-bayt. So why we worship Lord al-Ladhi at'amahum min ju'in wa amanahum min khawf. Hakala Allah Ta'ala, two things to Quraysh. Araft? Allah Ta'ala is the one, at'amahum min ju'in, but Allah's showing you, why worship Allah Ta'ala? Shukr. Worship is shukr. You show shukr for everything that Allah Ta'ala extends to you. What is that Allah Ta'ala extends to you? And inside of this world, Allah sustains you, Allah Ta'ala protects you. Shuf, shuf. That's why the Imam, like Habib Umar, they said there shouldn't be a single prayer, save that after you recite Surah Al-Quraysh. After every prayer, it's a word, yani, to recite Surah Al-Quraysh, okay? Gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He gives you maladhat dunya ajma'a, and you've got the entire dunya in that Allah Ta'ala sustains you with food and drink, mahma kan, regardless of the quality and the quantity. Akala minhu, and Allah Ta'ala knows that which now is what is given his slave, by what a slave needs, from food and drink, and likewise Allah Ta'ala secures you, places you in a state of aman, safety and security. And so hakada, يعني so the Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم liked, loved God. And it wasn't the like and love of God, but it was the effects of God that the Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم, which is what? Which is the issue of digestion, keeping the digestive tract healthy. Remember, a healthy gut is a healthy spirit. And it all connects back to the matlab. And the Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم, he's not sent to feed us. He's not sent us, quote unquote, to show us what foods we must love. That's not what he sent. But Allah Ta'ala, yuzakkihim wa yu'alimuhum al-kitaba wal-hikmah. But he sent to purify us, to show us how to purify ourselves. And that there in food, food. I mean, spirituality, it is not going to be said there's anything more important than diet and the spiritual path. And nothing more important than the diet, that which you consume, yani, on the spiritual path. A lot of us, we're inhibited spiritually. Why? Because of what we place inside of our tract. It becomes an inhibition for us. Okay? And so the Prophet liked God, dubba. And one day some food was presented to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or he was invited to partake in it. And so I began to look for the pieces of it, I have the gourd, the dubba, inside of what? Inside of the dish, and place them in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to eat, knowing that he liked it. You should have known that the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam liked it, prepared it due to the effects that it has, mashallah ta'ala. Even in his household, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have duties inside of the kitchen, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the duties of the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the gourd. So that's what he chose to do. Like, he would take the gourd, he'd be the one who would peel the gourd, and he'd be the one who'd cut up the gourd, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Hakadha the duty of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As in Aisha radhiyallahu anha wardaha, when asked about the character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, kana fi mihlati ahlihi, that he was in the what? The khidma, the servitude, the service of his family, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وبي إليه قال حدثنا قتيبة بن سعيد حدثنا حفص بن عياف ابن غياث عن إسماعيل ابن أبي خالد عن حكيم بن جابر عن أبيه رضي الله تعالى عنه قال دخلت على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فرأيت عنده دبان يقطع فقلت ما هذا قال نكثر به طعامنا. On the authority of Hakim ibn Jabir, authority of his father, Sayyidina Jabir, radiallahu ta'ala anhumah, who reported, I went to see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and saw a gourd being sliced. Okay? And I asked, what is that for? And I mean, it's the Rasul who slices the gourd. He's the one who cuts up the gourd, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ordinarily. And so he asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what's the gourd for? I mean, what's the use of the gourd, of the dubba? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, we increase our food with it. Okay, what do you mean you increase your food? Yes, the phrase baraka. That's clear. You increase, remember, baraka means increase. The lughat al-Arab. And then the second of them, as we say in English, thicken. Okay, you thicken the food, thicken the soup. Okay, by the usage of gourd. Okay, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Know from Imam Tirmidhi, qala Abu Isa, wa Jabir, hadhu wa Jabir ibn Tariq, wa yuqalu ibn Abi Tariq. ورجل من أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وصحبه وسلم ولا نعرف له إلا هذا الحديث الواحد وأبو خالد اسمه سعد. He had the issue of the Senate that this Jabir is Jabir ibn Tariq and not Jabir ibn Abdullah. He's the father of Hakim, يعني. And he is also called Ibn Abi Tariq, and he was a man from the companions of the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وصحبه وسلم. And we do not know of any other narrations from him besides this. It's the only hadith he narrated on the authority of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abu Khalid, his name is Sa'ad, this issue of transmission. وَبِي إِلَيْهِ قَالَ حَدَثْنَا قُتَيْبَ بِنْ سَعِيدَ عَنْ مَالِكِ بِنْ أَنَسٍ عَنْ إِسْحَاقِ بِنْ عَبْدِ اللَّهِ بِنْ أَبِي طَلْحَى أَنَّهُ سَمِعَ أَنَسِ بِنْ مَالِكٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهُ يَقُولُ إِنَّ خَيَّاطًا دَعَى رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ لِطَعَامِ صَنَعَهُ قال أنس فذهبت مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم إلى ذلك طعام قرب إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم خبزا من شعير ومرقا فيه دباء وقديد. And so the tradition here of Sayyidina, يعني قال أنس فرأيت النبي صلى الله عليه وصحبه وسلم يتتبع الدباء حوالي القصعة فلم أزل أحب الدباء من يومئذ. Sayyidina Anas rahimahullah ta'ala said, a tailor, a khayyat, once invited the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for a meal he had prepared sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And at the beginning of the hadith, he had humility. Because when he's saying a tailor, he's not necessarily seen a tailor, somebody of a high profession. Shuf, And no matter who summoned or invited the Prophet to eat, then the Prophet would readily respond. In the situation, even a slave, if a slave invited the Prophet, the Prophet would readily accept that invite. And that's from the humility of the Prophet. Remember, you got to remember this reality, is the one who responds to God. Subhanah, the one who visits God. Subhanah, the one who sees God. Subhanah, who speaks on the authority of God. Subhanah. And then there you are, a tailor or a slave or whatever they may be, and you're inviting the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he responds, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And so a tailor once invited the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi for a meal he prepared. And I said, I went with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa to partake of that food, okay? That food, and again, in the Lughat al-Arab, again, St. Anas, young though, but St. Anas is not necessarily skipping with joy in relation to the food he's going to. No doubt skipping with joy that he's with the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but by his language, you can say St. Anas, it's not like he's skipping with joy, because what's a tailor going to feed the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? The man presented to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam some barley bread and broth. Again, he presents to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Okay, some barley breath and broth, yani soup, in which was what? In which was pieces of gourd and dried strips of meat in it. Okay, so yani the gourd, the dubba, and qadid is like dried strips, is sun dried. And so qadid is sun dried meat, and that there, which gives us a sense, it's like the meat, quote unquote, yani, be careful with terms, of the poor, yani. The poor, they can't, so to call, afford fresh meat. And so what they take to is what's called the English jerky or sun-dried meat, where the animal is slaughtered and it's salinated. They're now exposed to the sun, yani. And then the sun dries it, and this is a preservative now. It's a way of preserving meat so we can have it. It can be sort of eaten, consumed, yani, quote unquote, within lengthened durations, yani. Yani, it lasts longer. And it's not, obviously we now, it's not necessarily a choice for modern man, because we have like fridges, we have freezers and what have you. But not necessarily just in those ages, in this age, hatta, when we lived inside of the desert, yani khalas, it's either an animal you've slaughtered right now, or it's qadid, or it's sun dried. They're the only two options you have, because there's no way to refrigerate or to water store food, yani in cold temperatures inside of the desert. And remember the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa, now when the man shivers and shakes in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in front of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, "Hayyin, hayyin, Ariz, Ariz, I'm the son of a woman who used to walk, consume, make hadid." And the Prophet is referencing, why are you shaking in front of me? The Prophet here in his humility, look, I'm a simple man, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from a simple family. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is what is saying in humility, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And so now this man presented the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam some barley bread and a broth that had pieces of gourd, dubba. Remember gourd, dubba, it's the more precise understanding that it is gourd. But remember, it's still from the family of pumpkin. So some people want to translate the term as pumpkin, yani, as pumpkin. Okay, which is an understanding, although more precise is as translated here, gourd and dried strips of meat, yani, of sun-dried meat in it. And I said, I saw the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam seek out the pieces of gourd on the sides of the bowl, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And his finger, yatatabba, the Rasul sallallahu hand, is why he's looking for the actual gourd, the pumpkin, to consume, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So from that day forward, I have not ceased loving gourd. Sayyidina Anas rahimahullah ta'ala says, I mean, in a riwayah, Sayyidina Anas says, kuntu akraha dubba, I used to hate it, yani. I used to hate it. He had a dislike for gourd until he sees the fingers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam seeking out the gourd, and I loved it from that day onwards. Sayyidina Anas rahimahullah ta'ala informing us. And that shows you, yani, how we must align our love and our like and our want with the love, the like, and the want of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And as in Tirmidhi relates inside of the Sunan, la yu'minu ahadukum hatta yakuna hawa'an taba'an lima jitu bihi. That none of you believe, and the Imams understand those statements ordinarily, as none of you have reached the perfection of faith, although the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never said the perfection of faith, although that's how it's understood. But he said, none of you believe until your desire is in accordance with what I have brought, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. وبي إليه قال حدثنا أحمد بن إبراهيم الدورقي وسلمة بن شبيب ومحمود بن غيلان قالوا حدثنا أبو أسامة عن هشام بن عروة عن أبيه عن عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها قالت كان النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم يحب الحلواء والعسل. Okay, on the authority of Aisha, the tradition that the Prophet loved sweet foods, يعني and honey, sweet foods and honey. Al-halwa, okay, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam wa sallam. And the sweetness that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loves are things that are naturally sweet. Okay, naturally sweet. Don't think that this is a love of the Prophet of anything that is sugary, like we told what we find inside of our day and age. Remember the Imams of Tib, of the Tib of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they say sugar is a poison, it's classified as a poison inside the Tib al Nabawi. And so the mind shouldn't go to, he loves sweet foods like he loves like desserts. The way the moderns want to consume any desserts, or anything that had a natural sweetness, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, mashallah ta'ala. Because remember, things that have a natural sweetness, just like things that have a natural bitterness, like salt, which again the Arab can see as sweet, that they assist in digestion. That's why often people, that's why in the sunnah of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, people will say that the sweet comes before the sour. Okay, just to assist in the digestion of the sour, okay? Sweet corn fair. So we love sweet foods, and that can obviously include the issue of dates, and they include the issue of fruits, things that are naturally and it's sweet. And as we'll see, and kind of yuhibbul hulwul barid, he loved sweet things and cool things, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Imams, rahimahullah ta'ala, said the hulu here, at the height of the hulu, so you get the point, is water. At the top of the continuum of that which is sweet is water, yani. So it contextualizes what is meant by sweet things. Sallallahu alayhi wa, you can have sweet water, you can have bitter water, you can have hard water, you can have soft water. Like water has attributes, yani. And so the Imams, rahimahullah ta'ala, in terms of the sweetness, top of the continuum, you say it's meant by water. As we know, if you understand this tradition, that you love water and honey, now you know that's one of the, as you'll see, one of the quotes or beverages I drinks of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is water and honey, as we come to in the chapter of Sharab, of that which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam drank. وَبِي إِلَيْهِ قَالْ حَدَثَنَا الْحَسَنِ بِنْ مُحَمَّدَ الزَّعْفَرَانِي حَدَثَنَا حَجَّاجِ بِنْ مُحَمَّدٍ قَالَ ابن جُرَيْجِ أَخْبَرَنِي مُحَمَّدِ بِنْ يُوسُفَ أَنَّ عَطَاءَ بْنَ يَسَارَ أَخْبَرَهُ أَنَّ أُمَّ سَلَمَةَ أَخْبَرَتْهُ أَنَّهَا قَرَّبَتْ إِلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ جَنْبًا مَشْوِيًّا فأكل منه ثم قام إلى صلاته وما توضأ. الحديث هي عن سيدنا عطاء بن يسار of the great imams of the tabi'in رضي الله تعالى عنه, that he relates that Salama, the blessed wife of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, informed him that she presented the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم with a roasted side portion of meat, okay, of which he ate صلى الله عليه وسلم. Afterwards he stood up to offer prayer and did not perform ritual ablution, okay, purification. And what you sort of want from that first and foremost is that the Prophet وسلم, is eating the side of the animal. So he consumes from the side of the animal, sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, which obviously gets into the issue of like ribs. Okay, ribs, if you want today. So that's the first thing, because we want to know what side of the animal, what part of the animal that the Prophet وسلم, consumed. That's the first thing. And then the second thing, which is obviously clear in the tradition, is that in that the Prophet ate food that had touched fire, that it did not negate his wudu, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it's a fiqhi issue, okay? Because obviously the fuqaha are going to debate for reason about whether when you eat something that has touched fire, and the imams, does it mean literally mean touch fire, or does it mean cooked? Okay, does it mean cooked? Okay, does that disturb the constitution? In no doubt whatsoever, yani, physiologically, eating anything that is touched by anything cooked, it disturbs the constitution. Like the body believes it's under attack whenever it eats cooked food. Okay, it's under attack. How can the body interpret it to anything touched fire? But the Imams, rahimahullah ta'ala, are now asking, well, is it to the point that the actual spiritual constitution is disrupted, such that now a person needs to remake their wudu? Again, the fuqaha ikhtilaf, there are differences of opinion in that regard. although in all the schools of jurisprudence, and it would dominate it, that it doesn't. It doesn't. But it's not like the Imams, rahimahullah ta'ala, have ignored it, like the Shafi'i Fuqaha, as an example, although يعني, they say it doesn't break your wudu, you still keep an eye upon it, an eye upon the hukum. يعني. And so like in blessed times, as an example, like the blessed month of Ramadan, they don't want a person to break their fast upon something that has touched fire and then immediately go to pray Salah. They don't want that, like Maghrib. Like you break your fast on something that's touched fire, then to go and pray Maghrib. Shafi'i Fuqaha don't want that. يعني. Why? Because of the position of other fuqaha that you've broken your wudu, yani, by eating, consuming something that has touched fire, and thereby in a month like Ramadan, you've lost your maghrib. And then maybe you lost your maghrib, you lost your sunnah of maghrib, you've lost your salat al-tasabih. Maybe if you quote, keep your wudu all the way to Isha, you lose your Isha, you lose your Taraweeh. All of that, your muqiyamah of no avail to you, yani, in front of Allah Ta'ala. Okay? And so, hakadha, that one from this tradition, and other traditions that are similar to it, but the basis of it, that it did not break the wudu of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallama. But then at the same time, you say, well, sure, if the hadith clear, and so sure, so why would the Imams even say that? Because then the Imams can say, sure, this khususiyah of the Nabi, this khususiyah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallama, that he can eat meat sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that has been roasted and not have to make wudu. You get the point? It's like the hadith saying Aisha, the Prophet ﷺ, never did Fajr enter the entrance of Fajr, save that I found the Prophet ﷺ sleeping. Okay? And that the Prophet ﷺ will find it, had the tradition is going to come inside the Shema'il, that the Prophet would sleep to the point that Yanfukh. Okay? Yanfukh. So let's understand Yanfukh as in the Rasul ﷺ is in stage 3, stage 4, the Prophet of sleep cycle. يعني. The Rasul is deep into sleep, which obviously has a meaning in Nubuwa. It's not sleep like we know it. But still, Aisha says that Yanfukh, something begins to blow, that deep. Then Bilal now comes to call the Adhan, the Rasul jumps up, leaves and prays without remaking his wudu. Now, shuf. And so the Imams, rahimahullah ta'ala, say, ha, khususir of the Nabi. That did only for the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I mean, the Prophet is sleeping. And you could try to interpret that he's sleeping in a way, mutamakkin, he's sleeping in a way that doesn't break his wudu ordinarily, but that's not understood. Sure, you understood the Prophet, this is a sleep of the Nabi, where he has gone to sleep as he ordinarily does, and upon his right side, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, facing Qibla. And yet now, when the Adhan comes, the Prophet stands up and prays without remaking his wudu, and Aisha stresses without remaking his wudu, and the Imams, rahimahullah ta'ala, says, that's khususir of the Nabi. And so, hakadha, some of the fuqaha can also see yani here. And remember, in just in terms of diet, as we're reading now, it's important to remember that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam rarely touches anything that touches fire. Rare, it's rare in his diet, sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is closer to a raw food diet than he is to the dominant cooked diets that all of us could partake in and indulge in gladly. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah yuhawwil al-ahwal al-ahsan al-hal, that Allah Ta'ala transforms our state to states that are even better. وفي إليه قال حدثنا قتيبة يعني ابن سعيد يعني حدثنا أبي ابن اللهيعة ابن لهيعة عن سليمان بن زياد عن عبد الله بن الحارث قال أكلنا مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم شواء في المسجد. Okay, عبد الله بن الحارث reported that we ate some grilled meat with the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه يعني وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم whilst in the mosque. Again, all you want from that, obviously, he's eaten grilled meat sallallahu alayhi wa sallam whilst inside the masjid, the permissibility of eating inside the masjid, and the presumption that inside the masjid that they're going to pray thereafter, okay, and they're eating meat that has touched fire. وبي إليه قال حدثنا محمود بن قيلان حدثنا وكيع حدثنا مسعر عن أبي صخرة جامع ابن شداد عن المغيرة ابن عبد الله عن المغيرة ابن شعبة رضي الله تعالى عنه قال ضفت مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ذات ليلة فأوتي بجنب مشوي ثم أخذ الشفرة فجعل يحز فحز لي بها منه قال فجاء بلال يؤذنه بصلاة فألقى الشفرة فقال ما له تربت يدا قال وكان شاربه قد وفى وقال له أقصه لك على سواك أو قصه على سواك. From the tradition here سينه مغيرة ابن شعبة رضي الله تعالى عنه يعني who said now I was with the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم one night as a guest and the roasted side of meat was presented to him and he took a large knife and began to slice it and he cut it صلى الله عليه وسلم and he sliced a piece يعني of the meat for me. Sayyidina Bilal رضي الله عنه وارضاه came and informed him that it was time for prayer and the prayer time has arrived and the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم then he placed the knife down and said what is the matter with him may his hands be dusty he had in the Rasul although the literal is that the Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم could be making dua against Sayyidina Bilal but as the principle is never does the Rasul make dua against which when the companions, the faithful, say that the Prophet was making dua for Yani. Yani may his hands be dusty, Yani with earth of Jannat Allah, the paradise of Allah subhanahu yani wa ta'ala, making dua for Sayyidina Bilal, radiallahu anhu wardahu. Because remember the point is that now is the Prophet size of his eaten, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we know the hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, that if the adhan goes and the food is saved, that you prefer the food over the salah. And you pray first, you eat first, and then you go to what? Then you go to pray. And so now that the Prophet is eaten, like why Bilal calling the adhan? The Prophet is saying, why are you calling the adhan? When it's food first and prayer later. Okay? Prayer later. And so the mustache, yani saying the Bilal, had grown long. Okay? And what's understood is grown long here, as you'll see by the tradition, it's not grown long lengthways, but widthways, like it's coming over the lip. The top lip of Sayyidina Bilal radiallahu ta'ala yani anhu warda. And so the Prophet said to him, I shall trim it for you by placing a toothstick on your upper lip. Okay? And so I put in the siwak under it, then you can trim it appropriately. And with the siwak, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi is saying, and so I shall trim it for you by placing a toothstick on your upper lip. Or the Prophet said, you must trim it by placing a toothstick on your upper lip. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi and the Rasul going to trim it with the same knife that he's cut the meat with sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. We're going to stop here for today. Do you have any questions inshallah ta'ala? One of the longer chapters in Shema. Do you have any questions inshallah ta'ala? Any questions? Yeah, we're on the chapter of what obviously we're on the chapter of food, so we try and keep the questions inshallah to the topic inshallah time. So the tying of the hair back, we don't know if the Prophet ﷺ tying his hair back.
Can we refrain from eating animals that have been mistreated?
For example, battery chickens. Obviously, the issue can you refrain? Yeah, and from the issue of food being toyib, then yeah, that is a reason to refrain from food. But it's not making a hukum upon the food. You're not making a hukum that the food is now haram. So you have to be very, very careful. Okay? Well, then there's many reasons one can sort of refrain out of a personal ethic, yani, or a higher ethic. But it doesn't mean that higher ethic now interferes with the legal ruling of the food in question.
What type of vinegar should one consume?
Yeah, the Allahu A'lam, it's not necessarily clear from the Sunnah what type of vinegar the Prophet consumed. Okay? And then in Ishuf, it just depends, yani. You get the fuqaha of a lot to say about what vinegar, the Shafi'i fuqaha being in a sense more stricter than Hanafi fuqaha as to what it constitutes vinegar that is legitimate for somebody to consume, yani. It's clear that the best of olive oil is olive oil that comes from the lands of Palestine, then lands of Palestine, and the closer to the epicenter, the better. The closer they are to the Haram of Jerusalem, the better, the higher that oil is. Okay, Shajar Mubarakah, yani fi min ardin mubarakah, from a blessed land.
Could you please tell me which color of vinegar or copper cells are consumed?
In
also, due to high cholesterol, I use extra virgin olive oil now to follow the sunnah. Does that olive oil have to be regularly boiled?
Allah Ta'ala alam, yani. Remember, the purer the better in terms of olive oil, and what the purer it being, the more blessed it is, that which is from Palestine, because olive oil Mediterranean, yani. So across the lands of the Mediterranean, you're going to find olive trees and olive oil. But the purest and the best, quote unquote, then you know, the extra virgin olive oil from Palestine and from the lands of Palestine. And nobody present? Anyway, any questions, people? Bismillah.
Did anyone mention
what
intention to have
when reading the No, they mentioned intention. Just the intention clear, yani. The intention is to worship of Allah Ta'ala out of shukr, yani, due to the blessings that Allah Ta'ala bestows. And the two most fundamental blessings for a human being, yani, is what? Is that you're sustained in life and you're protected in life. Otherwise, there's no meaning of worship. If somebody's not sustained, then they die. If somebody's not protected, then they die. So what's the meaning of worship? Okay.
On the issue.
Habib Umar mentioned after every single prayer, and then one should recite, yeah, it's Ayatul Kursi. Ayatul Kursi is something you should recite before the prayer and after the prayer. And Ayatul Kursi, and then one should also recite Surah Al-Inshirah. Especially in our day and age, the age of, you know, depression and anxiety and sadness, so Inshirah, that's the supreme surah for relieving oneself of what of types of, quote unquote, of mental ailments, yani, which often they are. As Alam Nashrah Laka Sadrak, the entire surah, and the intention is obviously clear, yani, to place one's heart in a state of repose after every single prayer, and then likewise Surah Al-Quraysh, in that order, Ayatul Kursi, and then Surah Al-Inshirah, and then Surah Al-Quraysh, okay, in that order. And the surahs in and of themselves are self-explanatory. What is the intention therein? Any questions, inshallah, those who are present now?
Who is under
iron or
waste
the
good money apart from the
water?
Is it okay to add
it
to food
or suggest? Yeah, no, it's okay. As you see, the Prophet would consume honey direct, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But likewise, he also consumes honey inside of a beverage with water. So, yeah. Now. Yes, sir.
Is there any reason why the doctors,
they imagine not to cook with olive oil? Because they have no clinical proof of that. Rather, the clinical proof is opposite. Yeah. Yeah, in oils, when it was clinical tests done upon different oils heated, they found that all oils are going to lose, quote unquote, a degree of their benefit, all oils, but the olive oil maintained the most benefit out of all oils, even when heated, when applied. So that day is like a sort of, it's like a tale, yani. The olive oil, you know, when people say like olive oil, when it's heated, when it's applied to fire, that it loses all of its benefit. That day, not true, yani. Not true, because there are certain oils that are going to be able to withstand that and maintain benefits, not to the degree of it being cold, not to the same degree, but at the same time, it's still beneficial. It's like honey, as an example. Honey, when heat is applied to honey, and like the benefits of honey dissipate, yani, loses its honey. But there are certain honeys, like Dawani honey, Hadrimi honey, that maintains its benefit even under heat conditions, yani. We got the point, and so again, it's for olive oil, that's not true. Clinically, it's not true, yani. See again? Well, Allah, you can advise whatever they want. I said, what we're saying is that olive oil, clinical studies, whether it's pumice or none, that it doesn't lose all of its benefits when heated. I think that's the point. Because the Prophet, وسلم, the hadith is going to be clear. As mentioned, you see further tradition of the Ansari with the hadith of Sayyidina Hassan Hussein, Sayyidina Abdullah bin Ja'far, that they used to cook with olive oil. They used to cook with olive oil for the Prophet. That's not going to be something that's lost its benefit if it's been saved to the Prophet. Naam.
How is the olive oil applied to the
Prophet? No, it's applied like you'd apply, like you use a cream. The same way you use a cream, the same way you use an olive oil. You use olive oil. Okay. I get that. Any questions? Any more questions?
Yeah.
Let's take a few, then we have to finish, inshallah. Please choose one that directly related to the topic.
Can all types of wood be classed as sunnah, or is it a specific type? All woods can be classed as sunnah?
Yeah, it's similar with clothing, isn't it? You get the point, because the imams can understand it in different ways. Yani, so you look them also at the family of dubba. That's the broader sunnah, which can obviously embrace pumpkin and the like. Yani, but the gourd, it's the bitter. That's not naturally sweet. That which is bitter, you say that is the literal sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in relation to dubba. I guess they say.
Is
Yunani tib like tib nabawi? Well, yeah, it's not tib nabawi, but no doubt, there are principles inside of Yunani tib that concur, quote unquote, with the principles inside of prophetic tib, inside of prophetic medicine. Okay, because from Yunani tib it precedes the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it may be a way to understand it is that the same way that Yunani logic has a place in religion, so like the Imams of the Asha'ira in particular are going to embrace Yunani logic, you get the point, like Greek logic. It's in the same way that the masters of what prophetic medicine have embraced Yunani tib to a degree. But we shouldn't conflate them as being the same. I mean, the purity of theology, the theology of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not Yunani, nor does it employ Yunani logic. No, like pure theology that the Prophet came with, it's not Greek theology, nor does it employ the systems of thought of the Greeks. That should be understood, okay? And the same way we understand in terms of medicine, that the medicine of the Greeks is not the medicine of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but the Imams have employed it, and it's a great effect.
Did the Prophet ever use
a utensil to eat? Did the Prophet ever use a utensil to eat? But we can see the occasion of the knife, but it's a knife aided by hand. But we're speaking about the Prophet using like a spoon or a fork. No, that's not what we understand. As we learn to use this hand. Okay, last question, inshallah ta'ala.
Please explain on the food which is touched by fire.
That's what we said. The Imams differ as to whether it means food that is literally touched by fire, which is the most extreme of it, or whether it means things that are cooked, cooked. And so when heat is applied to food, and remember, it's important, like in the animal kingdom, remember, fire to food is an aberration. It's not normal. We mentioned to students that at one point, it was only the human being. A human being is an animal. And when we eat food, it's from the animalistic dimension of our composite nature. If we're body and spirit, eating food is not from the spirit, okay? And negating food is from the spirit. But eating food is from the animalistic, the bashariya, the human dimension of what this thing called man, okay? But with an animal. And so animals eat. Spirit doesn't eat. Angels don't eat. Spirits don't eat. Animals eat, And so now what you find is that the only creature that what eats food cooked is the human being. Sure, but then the question must be asked why. And remember, the human being survived long enough without eating food that'll touch fire. Because fire is introduced, quote unquote, into human reality at a point in our history. And what about prior? I mean, there can be a presupposition that saying Adam alayhi salam never ate anything that touched fire. And so on. Sheath and what have you, the early prophets. Okay, and so that always is contextual, and that's what you see with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam eating food that has touched fire is not normal for the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, clinical studies will show that the human body is under attack at the blood cell level whenever, quote unquote, it eats anything that has consumed fire. It sees it as an attack, And so hekada, and so the Imams rahimahullah ta'ala, there are odds as to whether it means literally touch fire, like in terms of something being roasted on hot fire or grilled upon what exposed fire, or whether it means anything that has touched fire, meaning just being cooked, and even if it's placed inside of a pot and it's not literally touching fire, but it's been heated by the heat of that fire. Okay, I got the different opinion, Jenny.
So just for that question, should we reduce or eliminate or conception of cooked this way?
Of cooked food?
Of cooked this way.
Ah, yani, the sunnah is clear, yani. The question is, should we reduce the amount of cooked food that we eat or food that has been exposed to fire? Of course, yani. But that it's not, it's not just the issue of food that has been touched fire. Essentially, any dietary habits that are contradictory to quote unquote the Prophet in terms of quantity, quality, or frequency, then obviously we have to reduce yani. So it's not like singling out issue of cooked food or what have you, but it's looking at the prophetic diet across board in the broader sense. And the closer we are to it, and the closer, not we are just to physical health. Because I remember the point, يعني, it's not necessarily physical health, although we're obsessed with it. And the reason we're obsessed with physical health, because we're obsessed with living, يعني. Because we're obsessed with this world. Prophet says, and حب الدنيا وكراهية الموت. The age comes when, and which is our age, where they love the world, they love life, and they have an aversion to death, the Prophet said. But the reason we need that sort of prophetic diet is for spiritual health. You got the point? That's why, you know, the Imams, they were more concerned about the food they ate than they were about Qiyam al-Layl. You get the point? And for spiritual reasons. Because the reason, quote unquote, our tongue's not moist, the reason our hearts are not sensitive, the reason our limbs are not active and stayed in the worship of Allah Ta'ala, often reduced, it's reduced back to the gut, yani. From where we perceive now, yani, it's reduced back to the gut. And that gut, that food there, that is the nafs. You know, people trying to understand spiritual concepts such as the nafs, it's the food, yani. And that food is supplied to that creature that Allah Ta'ala says, Amara Bisu, that only ever commands evil. Okay? And so if you want to sort of transform the nafs, first, you must begin to cut off its supply, yani. Okay? Tayyib, inshallah ta'ala. Jazakumullah khairan, wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.